Hey, this is William with Foraging Truth. I'm filling in for Chuck today, and we're going to talk a little bit more about purple deadnettle and henbit deadnettle. We've had a lot of requests about how do you prepare the purple deadnettle and its cousin, the henbit deadnettle, when you find it in the wild and you've harvested it. Okay, so some things to remember when you're looking for deadnettle. One is you want to see these pink flowers that will pop out in a couple different directions, and that you will have opposing sets of leaves. So leaves on the left and right, front and back, and that they alternate like that. Make sure that the stem is square. So you can see it's part of the mint family, and mints generally are going to be edible. Of course, you want to make sure you source this from an area that you know isn't going to be covered in pesticide or any or weed killer or anything like that. If you look up here, you know, where the flowers are, there are quite a few flowers that can protrude from here, and each one of them is going to throw out a bunch of seeds like mints do. Mints are very, very good at making seeds and very good at spreading. So what we have here is the two strains of this. So these are the purple deadnettle, and you can see that they have the purple tops on them. And then over here, right next to it, we have the henbit deadnettle, which is also edible and simply lacks the purple that you would see on top of the purple deadnettle. So it's nice to see the two of them side by side so that you're able to take a look at that. All right, so let's harvest some of these and get started on preparing them. So another thing I wanted to point out about stems in general is that if you see milky sap inside of the stem that you squeeze out, stay away from it. Oftentimes stems with a milky sap in them are poisonous. One example of not being poisonous, of course, is the dandelion, but milky sap, stay away from it. Okay, so we have a nice little patch of purple deadnettle. Sometimes you find it in these small patches, sometimes you find it in larger groups. So reach down in and pluck them out. You know, you don't even have to grab all of them. If you don't grab all of them, then they can lay down seeds and you'll get some more the next year. So maybe we'll take, you know, about a third of what's there. So you know, just basically put them in a bowl. If you're out, you could bring a Ziploc bag or something like that. I will recommend one other thing about this though, that you might want to shake out any bugs, seeds or whatever that you can. Inspect them. So if any of them just don't look quite right, then, you know, toss them aside. And, you know, of course you want to clip off the root sections as well, so that you're basically getting the stalks, the leaves, and the flowers. Another thing I'd recommend here too is if you're new to eating something, it would be best to eat it in small quantities, washing it and then cooking it. There's a lot of things in the wild that are either better cooked or they're only safe to eat when they're cooked. Okay, so we've gathered some nice specimens of purple deadnettle right here. And, you know, we've cleaned out all the other foreign material. You know, you can see that when you pick them out of the ground, sometimes you end up with pieces of grass and things, and you don't want to cook that. And you want to take off the root sections, you know, so that you don't have any chance of foreign material or anything, and any leaves that are wilted, you know, pull those off, you know, so that you've got some nice healthy looking pieces. You know, make sure that there's nothing else in there. And so in a couple minutes these will be the water will be hot, we can throw them in, we can blanch them for a few minutes. Okay guys, so here we are in the kitchen, and we're going to be taking the purple deadnettle and tossing it into some boiling water to cook it for a little bit. And it's you know, it's got about a mild flavor like spinach, so it should turn out okay whether it's cooked or raw, but we're going to cook it for today. So if you would just want to hang out for a couple of minutes here, we're going to toss it in the pan and see what we end up with. While it's cooking, let's talk about a couple other things you can do with this plant. I've read that you can dry the leaves and use them when making tea, which means you could probably use the fresh leaves as well. And that you can take this plant and toss it in with your smoothies. If you're familiar with the smell of Swiss chard or kale or collards cooking, this won't be far off. In a future video, we'll discuss the process for drying leaves and making tea. Okay, so these are looking pretty well done here, so let's take them out and toss them on a plate. We got ourselves some cooked purple deadnettle. In a lot of ways, it really looks like spinach, smells like spinach. All right, so let's take a bite and see how this does. And, you know, it really has a kind of an aroma of, you know, collards or Swiss chard. So you might want to doctor this up with some salt and pepper or throw it in soup, like I mentioned about a smoothie. So let's take a bite. Definitely got a collard Swiss chard kind of taste to it. And, you know, very mild though. I think it's pretty good. And I, you know, would strongly suggest that you look into harvesting and trying out some purple deadnettle. One thing I would like to point out about this plant is that the stems, especially of the larger ones, can be a little bit tough. A little bit longer cooking may be required, such as, you know, slow cooking or, you know, adding to soup or something like that, so that it has more time for the stems to soften up. You can also just pick off the leaves and flowers and toss them in your salad. So we plan on making a bunch of other videos on various types of plants like the purple deadnettle that you can find in the Appalachian region. As a big disclaimer, I have to say, don't try this at home. I guess you could call me a professional, and that this is for entertainment and information and educational purposes only. However, if you would like to try this type of wild plant or any type of wild plant, you need to consult first with a local expert, follow their guidance, and make sure that you start small, that you go slow, you learn, and that you enjoy the process. So I hope you've enjoyed this video, and make sure that you like and subscribe and hit that notification bell so that you will be notified when more videos come out on this topic and lots of others. This is William, filling in for Chuck at Foraging Truth. Have a good day.
If you see the truth about our creation, if your faith in our Creator is strengthened by our message, we would like to hear from you.